In these 3D print quality review videos, I ditch all the prints that hide all the flaws of the printers and instead run them through multiple tests, prints that rather expose and show the true capabilities of each machine. So today we'll be testing the newly released QIDI Q1 PRO versus Flashforge A5M PRO and how their 3D print quality compares to the Bambu Lab P1S. Just after this sponsored segment by PCBWay, if you're looking for professional services like CNC machining, 3D printing even from metal, PCB manufacturing or the full range of all other services that are required for your projects, make sure to check them out, the link in the video description, and get 5 bucks off for your first purchase. I like to start by checking how fast and even the heatbeds of each printer heat up. Q1 PRO consumes around 300 watts max and it takes 4 minutes for the heat to spread evenly with around 6 degree difference in surface temperatures. The bed is rated at 120 degrees Celsius max. Meanwhile, the A5M PRO consumes around 250 watts max and it takes roughly 4 minutes to heat the bed evenly with only 2 degree difference in surface temperatures. Its heatbed is rated at 110 degrees Celsius max. The P1S heatbed is the most powerful out of these printers, consuming around 1000 watts max, and it takes roughly 4 minutes to evenly heat the bed with a 6 degree difference in surface temperature, but it is only rated at 100 degrees. Having a high power bed is not necessary, and without neither the Q1 PRO nor the A5M PRO to struggle to heat it to the advertised temperatures. But when printing materials that need hot chamber, it is always suggested to heat soak the printer first. That works great on the P1S because it has a powerful heater and you can raise the bed, turn on the auxiliary fan and dump more heat into the chamber. And for Q1 PRO that is irrelevant because it has a separate 300 watt heater to do that even quicker. But A5M PRO has neither a powerful heatbed nor a chamber heater. Currently you can't even enable fans and the heatbed turns off after 10 minutes. Plus you can't access a fully featured fluid or main cell interface despite the printer running Clipper, so heat soaking this printer is very inconvenient. Next are the true flow rates of the printers. I recently switched how I test and now I measure the actual extrusion width, as in my opinion that gives a more representative data on how well filaments are heated and how well they flow. The Q1 PRO has quite a beautiful hot end with a 30 mm long melt zone and an impressive max rated temperature of 350 degrees. It uses a 19 mm length copper nozzle that has a hardened steel tip. The max flow rate caps at around 20 cubic millimeters per second, but with under extrusion of only 3.4%. Meanwhile, the A5M PRO hot end is a beauty but in a completely different way. They use a brilliant quick switch system that allows you to change hot ends in seconds. Sadly, their max temperature is limited to only 280 degrees and the 0.4 mm nozzle is stainless and not hardened steel. But with printer you also get a 0.61 that is hardened. The melt zone of them is 36 mm, which makes it the longest of these three. This allows the printer to reach a 25 cubic millimeter per second flow rate with under extrusion of only 3%. Meanwhile, the stock hot end of P1S has only a melt zone of 26 mm with a 300 degree max temp rating. Although it reaches those same 20 cubic millimeters per second, that leads to under extrusion that is almost 2 times higher than on the Q1 PRO. Moving forward, we have the cooling performance. Q1 PRO with only the printhead fan enabled performed quite weak with only the front section of a print looking good. With additional auxiliary fan enabled, front and the right overhangs looked great, but others not so much. The A5M PRO with only the printhead fan active performed better and evenly across all directions. While the auxiliary fan helped a lot, the front and the right side still had small defects. Meanwhile, the P1S literally blows away the competition with better results while using only the printhead fan. And with the auxiliary fan set to 70% compared to 100% on other printers, the results looked flawless. Next on the list is the extrusion test. This will show how consistently the printhead can extrude the plastic, as that has a drastic impact on how good layers of your prints will look. For the first time during this test, we basically have identical results. That makes me so happy because previously tested printers like Q1 series and SQ1 suffered from a very irregular extrusion problem. Then the Z-hop consistency test. This mostly shows if there are any problems like the bed not returning to the previous position after Z-hops. Again, I'm happy to say that all of them perform well. But because Q1 PRO runs an older version of Clipper, it is the only printer of these where the spiral type Z-hops didn't work. Going forward, we have one of the most important tests of how well each printer levels the bed. Here I always select the bed leveling option, print squares and measure their thickness. We want the lines of a graph to be as flat as possible with the least difference between the thinnest and the thickest layer. When printing PLA, Q1 Pro had a pretty low difference of only 0.032 mm on average from two runs. It was the only printer from these three that had adaptive bed meshing, meaning that it saves time by only probing in the area where the print will be. A5M Pro performed almost identically with a difference of 0.035 mm. But the king remains unbeaten. P1S had more than a 50% lower difference of only 0.02 mm when printing PLA. However, ABS results are more interesting. Before I start the first print, I heat soak the printers for 30 minutes. Q1 Pro performance would be great if not for that one spot that for some reason constantly printed way too close to the bed. A5M Pro performs quite well too, but again heat soaking this printer is a complete nightmare as it switches off the heatbed after 10 minutes, you can't manually enable the auxiliary fan, and you don't have a standard clipper's fluid or main cell interface to access and fix all those issues. Then the P1S, it again performs the best. Bambu Lab really nailed those first layers and to this day I haven't tested any consumer for the printer that would give better results. The same goes for the ghosting artifacts during high acceleration. While the P1S applies way more smoothing compared to the clipper base for the printers, I actually prefer that because the artifacts won't transfer from the inner walls when you print them at high acceleration. The A5M Pro also performs really well and the only disappointing performance here is from Q1 Pro, especially on the Y-axis. The printer's belts seem too loose compared to other brands, but the problem is that Q1 Pro uses an automatic tensioning system with springs, and manually adjusting the tension is almost impossible. After I finished all the test prints, I managed to manually tighten the belts using some ingenuity. That gave a noticeable improvement, and with applied more aggressive EI type of input shaper, the results look quite decent. Later I disassembled the belt tensioning springs and printed some spacers for the springs to compress more and apply more tension to the belts. Unfortunately, it is quite a hard process. Next we have a new test, Califlower by Vector4D. It is a paid model but it gives automatic calculations with entered measurement values and possible corrections. In my opinion, the two most important results here are the difference between two axes and the skew angle. My A5M Pro unit had almost identical X versus Y print length results, but the prints were undersized the most. But all of the printers perform within a reasonable error. The skew angle in simple terms shows how square your prints will be. So for example, with a 200 mm square box, my Q1 Pro on this print will have a 0.14 mm deviation from a perfect square. My A5M Pro unit will have a 0 to 1 mm and the P1S around 0.24. This will vary from unit to unit the most, as on Corax-Y printers, uneven belt tension on A and B motors can skew the gantry. Another defect that is really annoying to see on our prints is the vertical fine artifacts. I would say that they all were more or less okay without too many visible defects. But Bambu Lab printers almost always will have an advantage because they have a motor noise cancelling feature that also reduces these artifacts. Next, the iconic 3D Benchy. I run this print at the max advertised acceleration and speed, which is most often capped by a max advertised flow rate. Probably to no one's surprise, the A5M Pro results looks the best because the hot end can actually melt the filament properly with that long melt zone. I would say the P1S comes in second place and the Q1 Pro the last. A similar trend with printing the details from that same 3D Bench print, although P1S seemed to be smoothing the corners the most on the acceleration tower print that we looked at before, here it performs the best. Meanwhile, both Q1 Pro and A5M Pro print details seem to be washed out way more. Last but not least is a practical print from ASA Filament. This was the only print where the printers were not a completely stock configuration. P1S had the inexpensive TZ 2.0 hotend and the Q1 Pro had a more tension belts. Looking closely at the back of the prints, I would say that the only print that stands out was from the P1S, mostly because the layer lines look the most consistent. The same story was with the front of the prints, but for some reason P1S had the ugly vertical artifacts on the curves, so I guess pick your poison. With all of these tests done, what is my opinion about each printer? First, the things that I didn't like about Q1 Pro. A lot of it feels way too janky. From the lids that don't close properly, the spool holder that feels like a bad joke, and a nozzle cleaning system that kinda works but again feels way too jank. Not to mention that the chamber heater runs high AC voltage through the fins when it is on. But the worst part is that if you live in Europe where you can plug things both ways, the heater fins could be always live. For your printer being orientated more to enclosed printing, having no filtration system and the filament change that needs opening the top lid and letting out the heat is far from ideal. I can nitpick smaller things like low resolution touchscreen or the PI plate being hard to put back in place because of a single backer. But the more I tested, the more I was not disappointed by its performance. The Hotend heats filament quite well and has high temp capabilities to easily print filaments like this ultra nylon where the best layer adhesion and strength is required. Fast chamber heating allows to heat soak the printer fast with no fuss and keep the high temps during the print. When printing PLA it is quite average as cooling performance is not that good, but for printing materials that need an enclosure it performs pretty well. I feel like this Q1 Pro printer is orientated to more advanced users who want to print a variety of different materials that need a hot chamber without spending too much on a printer. I think that around 450 bucks is a quite reasonable price. Just be aware of the questionable safety of a heater design and the jankiness in some other aspects. As for A5M Pro, it is a complete opposite for the Q1 Pro. This is the printer that is built almost as nicely as the Bambu Lab P1S. I really like the quick change hotends and their true high flow capabilities. The ability to easily and quickly change them is great and the best that I tested so far. It just feels like a finished product without any real flaws and jankiness. I truly think that from all the printers that I tested, this one comes the closest to the Bambu Lab quality and polish level hardware wise. Of course, there are some smaller negative things like power button that doesn't fully turn off the printer and the fan constantly spins. Plus you always need to press it to turn it on, so controlling printer with a smart socket is impossible. There is the same unnecessary and inconvenient way to change the filament by opening the lid and cutting it. The annoying trend of having spools on the back of the printers needs to finally stop. A sharp corner of a cable chain cutting into the printhead cable and constant cracking sounds from the heatbed when it is heating up or cooling down. Plus the handle starts getting in the way when the heatbed backers expands from the heat and you try to place the PI plate back in, so you might need to remove it. But most of these are very minor things. More major things are related to the firmware and the software. The biggest downside was the inability to print directly from the official Orca slicer. After 3 months of no progress from Flashforge, it seems that 3D printing communities save the day once again, and the direct G-code uploading feature will be supported in the 2.0 release of the Orca slicer. So the only inconvenient things that were left are the inability to manually control the fans and disable the automatic heatbed shutdown after 10 minutes when preheating, and possibly the wrong rotation distance value as I needed to compensate for the correct flow rates way too much. A5M Pro has such a nice hardware for the price, especially if you can pick it up at those 500 bucks. I just would like to see Flashforge not locking down access to the regular clipper interfaces like Fluid or Mainsail on their printers. That would allow easy fixing of firmware related issues and would be a huge advantage compared to the Bambu Lab's closed source firmware. A5M Pro is the first non-Bambu Lab printer that I'm actually looking forward to using daily and not just collecting dust like some others. Meanwhile, the P1S, in my opinion, is still not beaten overall. It prints the best and is the easiest to use, however it also costs the most. It really comes down to the nitty gritty stuff when choosing from these as each of them offers something slightly different. If you're interested in any of the products and would like to support the channel, make sure to check affiliate links in the video description. If you found this informative and useful, don't forget to leave a like. Huge thanks to everyone who supports my work on Patreon or YouTube. Well, that's all for me, and we'll see you next time.